know, there are a lot of Nobel laureates out there who've had them a lot longer than you have. But 20 years is significant. What has that done for you in your daily life?
Well, it actually hasn't really affected my daily life very much. I guess the main thing is that I get lots of emails from people asking me to do things that I don't want to do, and I don't do them. There are things that I will accept regardless of how I feel about doing them, but they usually have some emotional attachment to them. So I do spend a few minutes more a day saying, no, I won't do that. I've certainly done a lot more traveling, because there are things that I feel like I want to do. You have friends who you owe favors to, that sort of thing.
I remember talking to the fellow in Manchester a few years ago, 2 days or 3 days after he won the Nobel for discovering graphene. And he said at the time, my life is no longer my own.
Well, that's true. For the first year, it's not your own. You gradually, over the years, begin to take it back.
Well done. Okay. Oh, let's move on. What has it meant for your research?
It does give me a platform for pushing my current research, which is in economics. Because it gives me an opportunity to go to various venues and discuss it. Our topic is the effect of automation on the U.S. economy.
Oh, I wanted to talk a little about the buckyball and the discovery and the fact that now the story I've heard is that Exxon had found traces of it years before and ignored it. You guys found it and said, hey, we've got something here. You write the paper. And then it took a long time to convince people that, yes, this was correct. What was that like?
Well, it never bothered me. I mean, you know, I was pretty convinced that the original Buckyball story was correct. It seemed a little amazing, somewhat more amazing that you could make all of these large carbon cage compounds, the fullerenes, a whole wide variety of them. Harry and the three students that were involved were seeing conditions where the peak for carbon-60 became even more, much more pronounced than was shown in the Exxon data. And became, you know, they didn't, from the data that they published, there was no reason for them to think there was anything particularly special about C60. It's just that it happened in the work that we were doing with checking out Harry's ideas that we hit upon conditions where the C60 was much more prominent. And so, you know, if Mother Nature is trying to tell you something, you need to listen. I don't know, I never really worried about it being wrong because it satisfied all the requirements. I think most of my colleagues worried more than I did about being wrong. I had, you know, part of the things that made me feel secure is there were two other well-known scientists who were in it with me. So we'd go down together.
You don't do nearly as much nano.
No, and I don't do really any nano right now.
And your career kind of kept along the path of sensing and spectroscopy and the making and using the tools after the discovery with Rick and Harry. Is that what just made the most sense to you, is just to say, okay, put that
well,
over there?
I'll tell you how I got lost interest in carbon And Carmen Fullerene's, I guess it's Fullerene's work business, Rick was collecting all the papers about the Fullerenes and put them in three-ring binders with rings about that big. And I came in one day and he had four of those rings finished, and I think the fifth one started. And I said, I don't want to be in any field where all my, it'd be a full-time job keeping up with the literature. So that's why, that's when I, why I abandoned the area. And also, it's not really the kind of thing I like to do because I'm much more mathematically inclined than being a synthetic or synthetic chemist, which is what Rick turned himself into, a synthetic chemist.